$200 million, that's a lot of money. What do you plan to use it for?
Well, we need to meet this incredible demand we're seeing for the Impossible Sausage and the Impossible Burger. Our retail business, our grocery business, has grown over 60x from 150 grocery locations to now pushing over 8,000. And so we're excited to deploy more capital against our mission, which is to create delicious meat that you don't have to feel compromised by, entirely made from plants.
It's a mission we love hearing about. It's a question I'm sure you don't like answering, but gotta ask it. Talk to us about the valuation. There's reports that it's $4 billion back in March. Has it increased?
Well, I can tell you that our focus has been aided by investors who see a bigger and bigger opportunity for the long-term business and mission. Mm. You know, Impossible Foods wants to be an everyday part of everybody's lives, every meat eater's lives, whether they're in Asia or here in the U.S. And we've been fortunate. Today, we're announcing great partners in the form of Coatue, as well as existing investors like Mirae Asset Global, as well as, wonderful previous investors who joined alongside, like Temasek. So we don't comment on valuation, but I can tell you that we're very optimistic, as are our investors, about the future of this company.
David, talk to me then about the future of that composition mix. You've mentioned, you know, the growth within the grocery business, and then, of course, you have restaurant partners as well. How do you see that mix returning, if you think it will, to pre-pandemic levels, or is there now a new and permanent shift to pure groceries?
Well, there's no question that a number of our customers in food service have struggled with the shelter in places nationwide here in the U.S. We tried to innovate with them, allowing them to serve their end-use customers by shipping our raw Impossible Burger direct to the home. We've also tried to serve our meat eaters at home directly through our direct-to-consumer business, where something like 95% of those who eat our stuff directly served by us to their homes want to eat more of it on a repeat basis. But I think we have to focus on where the meat eater is going, and right now it's increasingly to their grocery store for meat, where, again, we want to be available and affordable, which is why partnering with places like Kroger and Walmart and soon more to come is an important current focus for the company.
And your customer base right now, David, I mean, are we talking primarily Americans here in the U.S.? Are there ambitions to go a little bit further abroad?
Well, as I mentioned, the mission of Impossible Foods is global. We launched our business outside the U.S. in Singapore, Hong Kong, Macau, because those Asian city-states are gateways culturally and set trends. And we know that our product is as relevant if you're a home chef in Asia as it is right in the middle of the country. You know, 9 out of 10 of our customers are self-declared meat eaters. And the thing about meat eaters is they're everywhere across the globe. So we certainly aspire to be one day everywhere that meat eaters are.
You mentioned Hong Kong, Macau. What about mainland China? There was a talk of a push there. How difficult is that in the current geopolitical environment?
Well, you know, our focus is to serve with excellence the markets we're currently in. We haven't announced plans yet for mainland China. But I'll tell you, we've been hard at work for years, actually, to serve eventually all the major meat eater markets, whether that includes mainland China or Europe or Brazil. But we need scale and we need to grow. And today's news of an additional $200 million allows us to build more capacity to serve more global customers.
David, why not then just go public or do a direct listing? We're near record highs on the S&P. You have retail investors who, almost in record levels, are coming out and quite literally, in this case, want to put their money where their mouth is. Why not take advantage of that?
Well, we certainly will not forego any strategic option. We're, to be clear, definitely not announcing an IPO or a direct listing or a SPAC, DSPAC today. But we need every strategic option, and we like to think we operate at the same rigor and discipline that our investors expect from us as if we were public. So that is an option for the company. All options are available, but today we are not announcing going public.
And so with regards to the financial position of the company, obviously we know the cash is there to grow. We've at least had some reports of some revenue figures in the past, though not directly from you, David. I am curious about profitability, margins, and how that works out in an environment here where the acquisition cost of some of your ingredients has fluctuated a lot over the last year or so.
Well, I think that our history is a good indication of our future. You know, in February, we voluntarily announced a 15% price reduction We did it because our mission requires us to be increasingly more affordable and accessible. But we also did it because our profitability potential is as strong as the biggest companies serving the meat eater today. We use a fraction of the resources that the incumbent industry does. We skip the animal, we just go right to the plants. And we designed our supply chain to leverage any world-class manufacturing facility. It's why we announced our partnership with OSI. So we are committed, as we reduce our costs, to share that with our investors, but importantly, our customers over time as well.
How about pricing strategy for customers in terms of actually being on par with meat, perhaps the more luxurious end of meat, but nevertheless in parity?
Well, our strategy on pricing, in the same long-term sense of time as our overall mission, which is we want every meat eater by 2035 to happily not have to pick something from an animal. Our ambition is us to be at the same cost as commodity ground meat or commodity steak if we enter that market. And the reason why we're committed to that is because our technology allows us to be not just cost competitive, but to offer our meat eaters a better product at the same time. Now we need scale. And so a big part of today's announcement is to fund to get to that scale. But we're very committed to providing that same low cost that the incumbent industry enjoys today.